I've got two theories on this, right? One, he started the leg dangle because he thought, if I just put that leg out, then if somebody's going to come up the inside, then I basically, that's going to buy me an extra, say, 30 centimeters. And, you know, the sort of that amount of precision. And he's thinking, no one's going to risk snapping my leg. So he either did it for that. But I've sort of got this feeling that he might have started doing it because he just thought, everyone's copying me, so I'm going to start dangling the leg. So I've got this feeling that there's going to be, like, when he retires, I think that, like, he's going to come out and go, oh, you know, that whole leg thing, it wasn't required.
You ready?
I am ready.
Take 142.
I was born ready.
Hey guys, welcome back to Last on the Breaks, the MotoGP podcast with myself, Matt Dunn, and Fran Wild joining me as ever. And you were just listening to our guest on today's show, Ross Noble, the comedian, giving his thoughts on the origin of the now famous MotoGP leg dangle. But Fran, what are we talking about on today's show?
Well, of course, MotoGP, but also motorcycling and Ross's love of the sport, but also beyond the sport, everything from his adventure riding to track days at Phillip Island, even did a tour of the UK on his bike, dictated the locations by Twitter, which would be a pretty interesting experience, I think. And of course, the most important question of our times, which is, of course, what connects British TV legend Des O'Connor to eight-time champion Marc Márquez?
Certainly one of the all-time most significant questions about MotoGP riders and one of the more random podcasts you'll probably actually get from us here. But a bit of context for those of you who may be wondering more about Ross Noble. I mean, feel free to go in your spare time and have a look at his Wikipedia and search him up if depending on where you are in
you
the world.
You said that spare time, like this part of their time is their job.
Yeah, well, it's ours. Ross Noble, massive, massive comedian. Obviously, you can hear that he very much grew up in the northeast of England, but since then he's done shows all around the world and is massive in both the UK and Australia, which is where he is actually joining us from in this podcast.
He is. He joins us from his lockdown bunker. But of course, it is the MotoGP podcast, so don't worry. It's still going to very much focus on your favourite sport and, of course, his wealth of experience riding as well, with plenty from slow speed with trials, track days with James Toseland, like we said, and also his favourite aspects of our sport. I think it's always interesting to hear from another fan, even if they are, quote-unquote, a famous person, which is great. So I think it's definitely an episode for both the bike and the fans of MotoGP, as well as, of course, fans of Ross Noble.
Yes, quite. But as ever, today's question that we want to pass on to you guys, which you'll hear about in the show a bit later on, do stick around for that one because it's pretty funny. Not either of us, of course, Ross, the professional comedian. But please let us know, write in the comments, write to us on Twitter. We want to know, what would your MotoGP race-winning celebration be?
Yeah, we do. Let us know, please. And stick around even further at the end for the Kenwood Not So Quick Fire this week, brought to you by Kenwood, for I think definitely the most extravagant answer to coffee or tea that you may ever have heard.
Yeah, surely one for the history books, that one. So I guess without further ado, let's hand over to us and Ross for this kind of pretty long show, to be honest. Is this your podcast setup you've got? Better than what you're doing to record your own one. Is that cardboard and stuff in the background?
So I've got bows and arrows. I've got a water supply, machetes, knives, gas mask.
I don't know what you're expecting the coronavirus to look like, but it seems more of a zombie apocalypse.
Yeah. Well, I've been doing these arsing about, you know, Instagram Live and stuff, and I've been doing quite a lot of, I just figured if you're going to be on a lot of Zoom calls, and I've been doing a bit of the odd sort of telly stuff where, you know, I just thought he keeps cutting to people's houses and they're just there trying to show off with their books, so I thought I would set up like a doomsday prepper situation behind
me. Brilliant.
Just funnier, isn't it?
So where are you in the world then? Because I thought you were living in Australia, but it seems with time zones you're back here in UK.
No, I'm here. I'm in Australia.
Ah.
I'm in not far from Phillip Island, actually. Down south of Melbourne.
San Remo, is it?
No, I'm on the Mornington Peninsula. That's where I am.
Okay. We got the ferry to there, I think, last year after the most insane time pressure to try and get the last one at 5 p.m. That's nice. I'm quite jealous.
So what did you... You got the ferry...
We did a pre-event with Jack Miller and Fabio Quartararo on Great Ocean Road.
Yeah,
and then
right.
Coming back, no one wanted to drive through Melbourne and then down. They decided to get the ferry, but the sat-nav said we'd need like an hour and 10 minutes, and it was about 55 minutes until the last one.
Right.
So,
you went from Queenscliff across to the bottom of the peninsula, and then did you get another ferry that took you across to the island, or did you drive to the island?
No, then we drove to the island and over the bridge, old school style. Well, that's cool. I'm very jealous then. That's nice.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you what, where I am in the world, I'm not far from where you grew up. At the moment, I'm in County Durham near Consett.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So...
Let me guess. Your eyesight was failing, so you drove to Barnet Castle. Is that right?
Exactly. I mean, it's funny. We did that on an Instagram Live yesterday with an actor in the US. He was like, where are you? Yeah. I said, I'm near County Durham. And he said, oh, I recognise that name lately. And I was like, let's not talk about why this has been in the news. Really appreciate it. It's been me trying to be reaching out to contact you, but Franz was the one who put your name forward to let's chat to Ross for the podcast.
Cool.
I thought you'd be a great shout. I want to first ask you, Ross, you're one of the only people in 2020 who's actually watched a live motorcycle race. You're at Phillip Island for World Superbikes.
Yeah, it was. Yeah.
So how was that? Right. And how does that feel to be one of the only people to watch it?
You know what? It was at the time I was. At the time I was. The whole Corona thing was sort of bubbling away. And I rode down there and I'd filled my, as I was stopping at petrol stations along the way, I was going in there and I was buying loads of hand sanitizer. And my mate who I was with was just going, what is wrong with you? Like, why are you buying all this hand sanitizer?
You're
I was going, trust me, we're going to need this soon. And then about a week and a half later, he went, I can't believe it. You bought about 40 hand sanitizers, but it was good. I mean, it was one of those ones where I was thinking, I thought I'll go and watch it down there, and then that'll be a good start so that I can. My plan this year was, because I was a bit slack last year. I was kind of really busy with work, and I was missing all sorts of events. So this year I thought, right, I'm going to make sure I watch everything. Like, I was going to watch everything. And then, not too much.
But what was it like being on the grid and stuff there? That must have been pretty cool. Because Phillip Island's always special with its MotoGP or World Superbikes. And the races were amazing.
Yeah. I mean, it's quite a magical place down there. It's funny because if you're not into, if you're not into bikes, then it's pretty much just like a bit of a holiday. It's nice, but you wouldn't go, you wouldn't necessarily pick it as your first choice of holiday destination. But it's good. It's sort of I used to go down because I lived over here about 10 years ago. We've just moved back. And I used to go and do a lot of track days down there, and it's in terms of like as a track, I can see why all the riders love it so much, because it's just this sort of, it's just insane, you just got like this kind of like insanely, you got an insanely fast straight that just leads into that kind of, you're right into it, and then out the back there, with Lukey Heights and all that, just that mad thing of, you kind of, the horizon is at a weird angle. The bike's lent right over at a weird angle, and then you sort of can't see over the top. And then you see over the top, and then and then as you're going down, there's that tight right-hander. And it's one of those things where, if you're riding around there quite fast, you stop and you just think, oh my Lord, like going the speeds that people who can actually go fast are going. It's just, you know, it just sort of boggles your mind, you know, because it's not, you know, like on a flat track, you know, you'd sort of go, wow, yeah, I'm doing what they're doing, but they're just going faster. There you just go, I don't know how these lads are actually not just crashing all the time, you know, because it's just up. It's like a roller coaster, basically. But also because it's one that, you know, it's so far away from all of the other rounds. It's the sort of thing where it doesn't get crazy busy down there. But people travel from all over Australia, so the atmosphere is always brilliant, you know. So yeah, it's good. I like it.
Sounds like you do. I honestly cannot imagine. Like, I've never actually done my bike license. I had a 125 for a little bit. But even just standing on the Bass Strait and then looking down into turn one, I cannot imagine how you could ever even ride that at like 40 miles an hour. When you first did it, before you kind of knew where you're going with the track and kind of got up to your limit a bit more, what's that feeling like? How do you approach it the first time?
It was pretty terrifying. It was the first track I ever went on as well.
Oh,
and
my
it
God.
Was just
you I started quite high up.
It couldn't work out what was going on. But what's funny though is that it's one of those things where like the difference between sort of like, you know, like a track day, you know, like a track day rider and, you know, and they're sort of, and even the guys that are right at the back in the MotoGP, it's just like, I was being a bit name droppy here. I was talking to James Toseland about it and I was saying to him, like, cause I used to go down there all the time. Used to do loads of track days. And I said to him, like, talk me through what, because there was a certain bits of it I got a bit obsessive about learning it, you know. In fact, it was what my favorite thing was, the final corner. I was just practicing that. There was one day where that's all I was doing. I was just kind of, you know, I was riding around and then I was just making sure that I just got this, the last corner onto the straight, you know, you make up all your speed there. And like, I did it. I was there for about 3 days. I was sort of building up. I just kept going over this same thing. And then I finally got to the point where I thought, oh, I've got this now. And I was coming out that final corner and I was right on it. And I thought, oh, I'm a legend here. I'm flying. And as I came out, there was a Korean racer and he was over just doing a bit of practice and that, and this guy had obviously been watching me just like trying to get this faster and faster, and as I went around, I was absolute nailing this, and this guy, he rode past me and he took his hand off his handlebars and gave me the thumbs up like, yep, I think you've got it. And I'm just like, yep, you're riding one-handed. It's just always just bringing you back down. But no, what I was going to say was that, so I was talking to James about it and saying like, you know, talk me through what you're doing. And he was talking about like, there was stuff that he was doing. Like he said, I think it was coming into turn three, he said he sort of backed off a little bit because you're going so fast. He said there's like a bump there and the front of the bike comes up. And it's one of those things where like a normal human being wouldn't even know that was there because you're just not going fast enough, you know.
Wow.
So it's one of those things where like I've got so much respect for the riders, you know, like that's kind of because it is literally just a different, you know, it's just like a different level. It's not even sort of vaguely in the ballpark, you know. It's just crazy time.
Yeah, I can imagine that. I mean, as Fran said, she rode a 125 for a little while. My sort of last experiences of riding was throwing my mate's 100cc motocross bike in his hedge and then unsurprisingly never invited me back. But I suppose for your ordinary punter, that a track to you, someone going at your speed, all due respect, is completely different to what a track is actually like to the guys who are just absolutely wringing its neck on the absolute limit.
Yeah, completely. Because they're looking at they're looking at different things as well, you know, like where they're, you know, where they're sort of, they're not noticing, they're going so fast, they're not noticing the things that you would, you would notice. So why did you, so, but see, so you're obviously, you love your racing, but you, why didn't you, what put you off? No, why aren't you riding?
For me, nothing's put me off other than money, the cost and stuff like that. Because so me and Farrell, like, little context about us. We work for Dorna, who were the commercial rights holders for MotoGP, and we both live in Spain, where the headquarters are, near just south of Barcelona. And so, you know, moving out there, and you know, we're fortunate enough where we both now travel to all the races and do jobs there. I do a bit of commentary, Fran does a bit of commentary in the press releases side. I also do a bit of social media, and then of course we do the podcast too. And it's just, yeah, it's just money. Like, it's one of my things where I'm thinking, later in life, build a few more savings, and then I'm gonna get one properly. But I'd love to. Yeah. We also don't live in the correct place to even have really a dirt bike to just go ripping in around the local trails and stuff, to be honest.
Right.
That's
right.
It.
Yeah, I did the CBT and then moved to Spain just before I was about test ready. And now I wish I'd made the effort to, like, come back a couple of weeks later and at least just do the test for the paperwork.
Right.
But one day we'll get there.
The thing is that we're pushing for is, like, actually – go on. Sorry. Oh, sorry for interrupting.
I was just going to say, like, so my first – the reason I got into bikes in the first place was because I moved to London. I'd always wanted a bike, never allowed one as a kid. And then when I moved to London, I thought I was going to get my license and all that. And then at the time, I don't know if this is still the case, but because of my job, basically landlords, comedians and stuntmen are the three highest category insurance that you can possibly get.
Really? I can actually believe that.
Yeah, well, I think they think that you're just going to drive, like, hilarious, like you drive a clown car and the wheels are going to fall off and there's all custard in your face or something. I think it's because a lot of comedians are raging alcoholics and, like, doing, like, crazy amounts of mileage. And then also it depends who you've got in the car as well, you know. I think they think that, you know, you're gonna write somebody off. I don't know. Anyway, so that it was through the roof. The insurance was through the roof. So I bought a 50cc pizza delivery bike, and it was one that the and at the time, I think this might have changed now, but you used to be able to ride it on a car license.
I think you still can.
I think you can. For 50, yeah.
Yeah, if you do like you still got to do your CBT and all that, but that was like a day. And then, so for ages, I was, I used to ride around and I would do big trips on it. I'd go down to Brighton on it, and as long as you didn't go on the motorway. So I just kind of, so, you know, that's worth doing. Just get yourself like a 50cc, like a ratty little thing, and then just ride that around for a bit. And then, or, if you're down in, if you're near Barcelona, you should go and do some trials riding, because because down in Spain they love it, don't they? It's the big thing down there, and that's you know, I love a bit of trials, and it's worth it's worth doing that, because then you sort of, by the time you come to do your license, you'll be so technically, you know, even just spending a little bit of time on a trials bike, your clutch control and everything would be amazing. So, yeah, maybe do that.
Trials blows my mind, to be honest. The amount of control is just insane. Like, I mean, it's insane how people can go 300 kilometers an hour and what the guys in MotoGP and World SBK do, but that's another level. Yeah, watching the best trials rider in the world, it's like the slowest Bo, but even more impressive thing.
Yeah, well, that's the mad thing. Like, all of the sort of greatest riders in every discipline, they all kind of look at trials riders and go, you know, the top lads in trials are just, yeah, that's they're the the masters, you know.
That's something I wanted that we wrote down, like looking, researching you and stuff like that. You've literally done like TV shows and videos of it, everything in bikes. You've done, I've seen you do mini motors with MCN, you did trials with Fifth Gear and Dougie Lampkin, you've done all these motorbike tours and track days as well. So do you just respect every single aspect, like the guys who can go as slow as possible, like they can just do a track stand for 2 minutes, and then same as the guys who can go 350 kilometers an hour?
Oh yeah, completely. You know, I've been really lucky to sort of, you know, I've had a chance to sort of meet and ride with, you know, like some of the best in the world, you know. And it's sort of, it's like anything, you know. It's sort of like, you know, it's like if you see somebody, it's all very well playing a few chords on the guitar, you know, but if you're next to Jimi Hendrix, it's one of them things where, yeah, it's just, and I really like the fact that like the dedication, you know, the sort of, you know, putting that much time into it, and also the physically as well, you know, it always makes me laugh, you know. Like, I'm not into football, I couldn't care less about football. And, you know, you see these lads in the football, and they get, you know, they barely get touched, and they fall down, and they just lie there for 30 seconds, and just, you know, or a minute, and they're just there, and they're just writhing around in pain, and then they're helped up, and they're sort of limping around. They're like, oh no, don't come too close. And then, you know, you watch, there'll be like somebody sliding along the tarmac, like, you know, like going some crazy speed. And they haven't even stopped, and they're already getting up and just, you know, pulling their boot back, trying to get on, and just, you know, and then shouting at the marshals, get it going, get it going. There's none of this, oh, I've just had a massive crash at whatever speed I was going at, you know. So it's ultimate modern day gladiators, you know. But yeah, go on.
No, I was going to say, it is mental when you see a rider come off and they're sliding, and then a few, you can see even for them, maybe perception of speed is not always quite what you think, because they're trying to get up and run with it when they're still sliding at like 50 miles an hour.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking of when you said that.
It's great. I love it. That is one of my favorite. But I think the best way to describe that is, you know, when you, you know, like if you're on a motorway and you're doing 70 on a motorway, and then all of a sudden you slow down to, and then you go into a 30, come off the motorway, and then you're onto an estate or whatever, and it's down at 30, and you're driving along and you're looking at the 30, and you're going, you know, your brain's saying, I could probably run at this speed. Well, obviously, when you're outside and that's happening, yeah, it is one of my favorite things, because you'll see every now and again, you know, you'll see somebody, like they'll stand up, and there's just this, it's like watching them landing on the moon, you know, just flying along like that. Yeah.
It's pretty funny, isn't it? No, it's one of the, and especially now these days, we've seen so many cases in the last couple of years, because it was Marquez who obviously changed it when his bike cut out at Circuit of the Americas in 2013, and he just sprinted the length of pit lane to get back on his other bike, and then got pole position. Yeah. And now there's no excuse for all the other guys. They have any opportunity they can to run, or like they're even running with the bikes across the finish line if they crash at the final corner, and it's like, there's no excuse anymore. They're just always running. I'm amazed how much they actually even can run in just the leathers and helmet. I mean, probably faster than all of us three actually running in shorts and t-shirt.
Yeah, but but again, you know, I think the sort of the days of you know, the days of the Barry Sheens of this world, you know, drilling a hole in his helmet so he can have a smoke. they're so insanely fit. They're probably, to be honest, they're probably there just going, I've spent my entire life in the gym, I really need to show people that I can run in leathers, and it doesn't bother me.
It's true.
It is pretty impressive, even just that. Like, I think, like, you get a few athletes as well who just do other events that are people's main focus just because they can, because they're fit enough.
Yes.
Like, we get a few of the guys in MotoGP just doing ridiculous cycling races. Jenson Button was a good example from F1 when he just started doing triathlons and being incredibly competitive. Yeah, it's crazy, the level of fitness, even though that doesn't look like that's what you need. But it is such an important thing now, isn't it? Compared to, yeah, that Barry Sheen kind of generation when it was all just a few beers and a smoke after the flags dropped, or maybe even right before.
I mean, that's the other thing as well. You know, you've just sort of, you know, if you do, especially on a hot day, you know, if you do sort of 20 minutes of, you know, 20 minutes of tanking along nicely, you do 20 minutes of that around a track on a sports bike, and you feel it afterwards. It's not, you know, I almost feel like there should be a thing before the race where everyone's allowed to just have a bit of a go, and then just you've got some sort of idea.
Yeah, that's a good idea, actually. Well, in looking at some of the stuff you've done as well, I forgot that you were on MotoGP Tonight, the old BT Sports show that they did back in 2014, yeah. And you're on that lean machine. You did that 30-second challenge, and I wonder whether that's the most physical thing that Ross has ever done on a bike, because it certainly looked it.
How dare you? I wasn't too bad. That
it looks knackering.
It was such an insane thing because it wasn't massively like being on a bike. It was a bit like just being on some sort of, it's like being on a weird, like a thing in the gym, you know, like some sort of, like a Stairmaster with the springs the wrong way or something. But yeah, that was fun. That was fun, that show. Now, I know this goes out all around the world, but there was, because Northampton is, Des O'Connor is from Northampton. So I was trying to convince Marquez that when he, like, if he was going to win, that as a tribute to local boy Des O'Connor, he should wear a Des O'Connor mask. And he seemed interested, but trying to explain. And all the Brits, we were all just going, come on, you've just imagined like winning the race and then putting on a Des O'Connor mask just to see if the rest of the world were just going, who is that? Who is that mahogany-faced 1970s songster?
Oh, my Lord. That would be quite something to see. I bet a lot of people as well, if you aren't a UK or extremely niche overseas listener, Google Des O'Connor.
Well, actually, in the last episode we did, at the end, in the outro, we said, oh, here's things after this episode you need to go on YouTube. Last episode it was, you should go on YouTube and find on the internet the difference between a MotoGP bike and an F1 car and maggots and Beckett's at Silverstone. This one's going to be, go and check out Des O'Connor.
check it out. You know, if you're listening in like Latvia or somewhere, check out Des O'Connor. But we were trying to, after that show, because we were just saying, like, you know, because, you know, sometimes, you know how, like, the celebrations, like, sometimes they can be, like, really tenuous, and you're sort of going, why are they doing that? What's the significance of that? So we were sort of saying, well, if you don't want to do Des, he was like, I don't know who Des O'Connor is, and he thought we were taking the mickey, you know, but then we said, why don't you just get, like, a flower pot and put, like, a flower pot on your head, and then so that the press and all the fans are trying to work out what the significance is of the flower pot. I think you had bigger fish to fry.
I'm sure they're in the Repsol Honda notebook of ideas now, though. Don't you worry. One of these days, there'll be a flower pot on Des O'Connor.
You know, you might as well, just like, you know, if you win in as much as he is, just do some sort of celebration.
I always wonder this because, like, when Danny Pedrosa was going to retire and there was all of the rumours and everything, and I got sent on one of the Thursdays to do the media debrief, and he's obviously hates doing that. So he's just like, ugh. And like, I was like, I know, I've got to ask you the questions because that's why I'm here. He answered them. And I said afterwards, if you hate this so much, and if you are genuinely going to retire and you're like, there's nothing you're going to lose here, why don't you just tell people something crazy? Like, why don't you just say, like, yeah, I've just signed for Scuderia Ferrari. It's like,
yeah, you might as well.
Just say, sometimes just have a bit of a laugh with it. I mean, we aren't trying to encourage that from our riders, but it was just a funny thing. Like, you can just say something funny sometimes, just break that ice a little bit, take the heat off.
But the trouble is, though, is that whatever you say in an interview, it then goes into the archive, and you get asked that question again and again every time. It's like somebody put on Wikipedia that I used to be a backing singer for the band The Cane Gang. Now, The Cane Gang used to sing the opening theme music to a British children's television program called Biker Grove.
Oh, no, that, not that. Oh, God.
There you go. So there's something else. After you've done Des O'Connor, check out Biker Grove. And the entire song just went, Biker Grove.
Biker.
Biker, biker.
We drove through it the other week, actually, Biker up here.
Oh, amazing. Yeah.
Well, weirdly, Biker Grove wasn't filmed in Biker.
Yeah.
It was filmed, so, you know, it's tricky. But and then at the end it went, down at Biker Grove. And, yeah, and apparently that was me doing that. And it's one of them things where once it's on your Wikipedia, they go, no, you were in. So that's probably why they don't do it. Because if they say, you know, because he could make up anything, he could say something like, I'll put a lucky mouse's spine in my boot every time I race. I've got the spine of a mouse and I just slide it into the boot. And then they would be asked about it like forever.
Do you know what? We could actually put that as the title of the podcast somehow and then just try and set everybody else off to go and ask the riders what they put in the bottom of their boots, to be honest. We're perfectly.
That's a great idea. What do you put in your boots for good luck? Yeah. just keep asking them that and just see if they go. Because if you get asked that enough, because what will happen? I've got this theory, right? I've got this theory, like, you know how, like, when you know how Rossi brought in that thing of, you know, the leg dangle, right? Mm-hmm. And like, it was the sort of thing where, like, so he starts dangling the leg and, you know, and now obviously he said at the time it was because of the way the bike was set up and it just made the whole thing, it just steadied him as he was, you know, as he was going around the corner. And now I've got two theories on this, right? One, he started the leg dangle because he thought, if I just put that leg out, then if somebody's going to come up the inside, then I basically, that's going to buy me an extra, say, 30 centimetres. And, you know, the sort of that amount of precision. And he's thinking, no one's going to risk snapping my leg. So he either did it for that. But I've sort of got this feeling that he might have started doing it because he just thought, everyone's copying me, so I'm going to start dangling the leg. So I've got this feeling that there's going to be, like, when he retires, I think that, like, he's going to come out and go, oh, you know, that whole leg thing, it wasn't required. I literally did it just to see if everyone else would copy.
I think there are certain things which actually, if one rider does it, they'll all start doing it. And it's completely true.
Yeah, it's true that with great power comes great responsibility to also make sure you don't get too cocky with trying to change everything.
I always get the feeling that, like, I always think that Lorenzo's probably, you know, when you buy those action figures and they come in the sort of plastic bubble, you know, they'll be like those Star Wars figures where they'll have, like, sort of a piece of cardboard and then the plastic bit over the top where they're in the thing. I always imagine, for some reason, I always imagine Lorenzo sleeps in a giant one of them.
What, just puts himself away at night?
Yeah, no, I think he's just, like, got a big cardboard pack. Like, he just strikes me as the sort, you know, like, with all the, you know, all that sort of sports psychology and all the rest of it, that, yeah, he doesn't, I think he just literally, they put him in the vacuum pack. And he stands up with his arms out to the side.
Maybe that's why he looks so relaxed now he's retired. He's allowed to sleep in a proper bed now.
He doesn't have to be in there. I don't have to, you know, shove the air in the bottom or something.
Hopefully.
It's quite a theory.
Yeah, go on. What were you going to ask, Fran? Oh, sorry, I was going to interrupt you then.
No, I was just going to go back to Ross on bikes.
Yeah.
And you've done a few different things, not just like riding and you enjoying it, but like kind of competitive stuff. You did the Red Bull Romaniacs.
Yeah.
I think you've done a bit of road tripping with Charlie Borman as well. What's your favorite kind of experience of them, and why are you doing them? What is the attraction of doing that more than just you riding and track days and that kind of stuff?
I started off like, so I was, you know, I do the track days now, sort of, and I was doing, you know, like doing the green lane and, you know, going off riding the dirt bikes, you know, just sort of on the, you know, just going off for the day, you know, and having a bit of a ride. And then I was in Wales. I was down in Wales doing a bit of off-road riding down there. And the guy that runs, you know, Touratech, that do all the bike bits and stuff. The guy that runs that also has he runs this 24-hour, it's a 24-hour enduro race, quite a full-on. So you start on the Saturday night and then you ride for 24 hours. You know, you're allowed to fuel up, but you don't stop. And so it's one of those things where I'd never raced before and we were in the pub and he just went, oh, we got this on next week. And he just jokingly went, oh, you should come and enter, you know. So I taught this mate of mine, I said, we should do it. Never done it. Hadn't even done like a local Hare and Hounds or whatever.
And a week before with plenty of time to train for it.
Hopelessly out of our depth, didn't know what we were doing. And then I just really loved it, you know. So then I spent the next 5 years just going back and just, you know, just racing this insane. Because also the thing that appealed to me was, it's like, you know, once I get out riding, I don't want to stop. I'm like a little kid, like, time for your tea, you know, get a right hoof. So it's just, you didn't have to stop. So yeah, so I did that. And then I just really enjoyed racing. But it was one of those things where I didn't really, racing enduro is sort of it's just really accessible, you know. You don't have to have like a, you know, once you've got your bike and your gear, you're pretty much set, you know. So I started doing that. And then I got into, I noticed that all the guys that were really good on the technical stuff were like from a trials background. So I then started, I bought a trials bike and started playing around with that. And then that became, so I was doing the trials and then I was doing the extreme enduros. That's how I ended up doing, Romaniacs and Roof of Africa. And it's just like, the more extreme it was, just the more fun it was, because it was, you know, it wasn't just like racing around a field. It was just kind of like, oh, I'm in the middle of Transylvania and there's a, you know, and there's bikes flying over my head and stuff. And it was one of those things where I just loved every minute of it. And that's kind of, and then it was doing the trials in order to get better at the enduro when I like really fell in love with trials. And then of course I don't do anything by halves. I literally just have to fully commit. And then that's when I was doing the trials and I started competing in the trials. And that's when I went, I'm going to go off and do the Scottish 60, you know, which is pretty much like for an amateur sort of club rider. That's like the, you know, you're riding alongside like the, you know, like the best in the world, you know. So I went and did that and just got a bit obsessed with it. And then with that one, a month before, the TV lot went, oh, we should make a show out of this. This was just going to be for fun. So then all of a sudden I had the added pressure of having a TV crew following us. So yeah, it's one of those things where like, left to my own devices, I'd just go out and I'd just ride all day. And it's just fun to, you know, racing. I just really like the racing because somebody else has set the track out and, you know, you kind of, you see someone and you think, oh, I'll pick them off. And then you, you try and keep up with somebody that's way faster than you, try and see how long you can stay with them. And it's just playing, isn't it? I just like playing on my bike.
It definitely seems like we always say about a lot of the MotoGP riders these days with the fitness and stuff, MotoGP riders use MotoGP to fund their cycling habits or their other sport habits. It definitely seems like you got into being a comic to fund your motorcycling habit. Do you see it that way? Was that a plan? Or
certainly, yeah. There's a lot to be said for that, to be honest. Oh, you've just gone completely green.
Me? Yeah.
Can you still hear me all right?
Yeah, you're fine.
I can see you. Oh, yeah, you look fine.
That's weird. You've literally gone green. wow.
Strange.
Wow, what has happened there?
What, are we just a green phase of green
you've
shade?
You've literally gone like, hang on. You've gone like the Predator. Oh, there you go. Hang on.
Oh, no, you've disappeared for me. I'm just looking at myself.
Yeah, I'm just looking at myself as well.
Oh, where have I gone? Sorry.
Pretty much my ultimate nightmare.
I know.
Am I back?
Coming back? Yeah, you're back. Yeah, you're there.
It's okay. I'm back. Fantastic. What was it? Yeah, no. You're right. I mean, it's kind of. Have you spoken to? You must have talked to Carl Cox. Have you on here?
We haven't.
But he's got to be actually a good shout for the near future, haven't we? Met him at Phillip Island a few times because he lives there, doesn't he?
He lives just up the road from me. He lives pretty much next to my kid's school. So bizarre. Somebody went, Carl Cox just lives around the corner. I was like, oh, okay, didn't know that. But, I think, he's the same, he's a superstar DJ, but he's pretty much doing it to fund his bike habit. But I was quite lucky because I managed to combine the two, So I in 2007, I did a tour of Australia, which we made into a TV show. And that was, we did a 80-day tour, and it was a full, well, it wasn't just a full loop. It was a loop and zigzagging across the middle of the country as well, down the East Coast. And that was no airplanes at all. That was all on my bike. That was 26,000 kilometers we did, and that was just an excuse to ride around,
Yeah, because it seemed like I think I watched also first for a couple of minutes of your freewheeling show on your first episode, and you were like, I'm not sure how much of a TV show this is, but it's definitely something to do. And at that point, I was just like. You crafty bugger, you've just done this. You can go tour around Britain anyways.
I mean, the thing about the freewheeling was that it was, so the idea of the show was basically I was on my bike, and then there was no sort of format to the show. I would literally tweet and just say, what are you doing? What's happening? And I'll come and visit you. And then we sort of made up what the show. So, like, there was times where... It was kind of it wasn't really a chat show. It sort of had elements of like, I'd go and interview people, but then we just go to people's work, and then sometimes it was a travel show, but we never featured like touristy things. Somebody would go. My favorite episode was when somebody said, "Don't come to Northampton; it's shit." So we went to Northampton and we devoted an hour of television to basically proving whether Northampton, just deciding whether Northampton was shit or not. And we ended up in a garden of Robert Llewellyn's old house. Robert Llewellyn, we convinced him to come along. We made we went to a pottery centre and we painted up. We made a fake blue plaque out of a dinner plate. And then we got the mayor of Northampton, the head of the council, the 1976 sports personality of the year, and a woman dressed as Tina Turner. And we staged a ceremony and just to something to do. So that whole show was basically just kind of, but even though it was just mucking about, it was incredibly intense to make. Because we had a week to make each episode, and it was basically like, if we don't film anything, we've got, like, we would have had to have gone back to the channel. They were like ringing up going, what are you doing? And I go, oh, I'm in Wales. I'm in a bank vault. Someone's given me a bag of custard. And that was, do you know what I mean? It was just like, yep, that'll do. And then off we went. So, yeah. So as much as it was great fun riding around Britain, didn't really have any time to, sort of enjoy the, it wasn't leisurely, that show. It was just, it was 12 hours a day of just desperately just seeing what we could, just trying to film anything that we could turn into a TV show. I loved it. It was great. Looking back on it now, I don't know how we did it. It was just, it was pretty insane, but it's good fun.
Brilliant. Absolutely brilliant. We just wanted to ask you, because I know you got to go to your next sort of commitment fairly soon.
Yeah.
Want to ask you a couple of questions just about MotoGP then, as well. Like, what are your favourite sort of storylines from the championship? What sort of riders do you look at most? Do you just appreciate the riding, or do you think like, oh, I love that guy where he's come from, or I love an underdog, that sort of thing? What really gets you going in the sport?
I really like it when you see like all of them kind of up against it, you know. I think like I know it sort of slows everything down, but I really love a wet race, you know, because it just, you know, not only is it that thing of going, oh, is that, or timing wise, is that person gonna get it, you know,
gaps go down so much quicker in the wet as well. If someone gets into a groove, like a 2 second gap can disappear in like two laps.
Yeah. And also, you know that, like, and it's a bit it's sadistic, I suppose, but like you know, you just know how difficult it is, you know. So that's I think it was Christopher Mullen 1 year did this incredible ride in the wet, you know, like you know, just seeing that sort of because you know, it just instantly it becomes slower, but there's so much more going on, you know. And obviously it's great, you know. It's always nice when is there any sort of massive rivalries, like real, you know, nasty rivalries now? But well, I did really enjoy that era of, you know, like with Biaggi and Rossi and Gibbonau and all that, you know. I think that was...
Classic era.
You know, it was just such a, you know, because it wasn't just about watching amazing racing. It was, you knew there was... You know, there was more to it, you know.
I guess, yeah, now we have like the Rossi Marquez rivalry, but it's not on track that often. So it's got a bit of a different flavor to it, I think, than those guys where, yeah, it'd be a similar kind of rivalry, but every single Sunday they'd be in the same six feet of tarmac. Every single day, it just makes it. It's a bit of a difference, isn't it? Now,
and a lot of people talk about how the rivalries are actually too nice now. Sometimes there's some bubbling away. It's funny because you got Marquez versus Dovizioso, which is a rivalry, but there's so much respect there. It's nothing like what you had with Rossi and Biaggi and everything like that. Then, you know, we first saw at Phillip Island last year, Marquez versus Vinales. That was the first sort of showdown then to have. But even still, it's not like it used to be, in a way, which some people in favour of. It's nice to be nice. And then some people are like, I wish they hated each other a bit more, you know.
Yeah, it's tricky, isn't it? Because you sort of, I still maintain my favourite race of all time was Rossi and Stoner at Laguna Seca.
Mm.
I still think that was, you know, there's been nothing, you know, close to that. The fact that, you know, anyone else would have just, like, both of them technically should have crashed, but they just didn't. And you're watching it going, like, how is this possible? Like, how can this, you know, I still think that was,
it's awesome. An absolute all-timer, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's, Right.
We've got a quick fire round, haven't we, to finish off with?
Oh, God, here
we can. It shouldn't be too stressful.
Yeah, right. we only came up with the questions about an hour ago. So
it's also, I think the way we've been introducing this, I've just realised it, makes it almost sound like it's some sort of quiz. Like, you don't have to know any answers.
Yeah. I know, it's just your thoughts. That I don't claim to be an expert at all. Go on then.
Don't worry.
Do you want to introduce it, Fran?
Yeah, so it's sponsored by our friends at Kenwood, who also do the radios in the MotoGP paddock to make us all secret agency on the go.
And they do the kettles as well. They do
a
whole range of things. I didn't know it, actually.
Well, it's like my first guitar was a Yamaha.
Yamaha, the musical instruments. That sort of, there's a great, Tim Vine had a great joke where he went, he said, I went into the electrical shop, said, can somebody sell me a kettle? He said, Kenwood, go and get him then.
There you go.
Go on then. Yeah. So Kenwood. Yeah. Right. For all your radio and kettle needs. Yeah.
Matt, do you want to start?
Yeah.
Off?
Okay. Well, the Kenwood quickfire then. So it's just some quickfire questions. You can ramble on a little bit if you fancy, but a couple of them will be a bit quicker. So the first one is coffee or tea.
I go tea, but always a mint tea. Ideally, a Moroccan mint. Don't drink normal tea. Don't drink normal coffee. I only drink Moroccan mint tea.
Wow, how posh of you.
That's an incredibly niche answer. Okay, so we've used this on the last one, but it was an also Australian, so we're going to go for it again. So you've got some themes there with where you are. Marmite or Vegemite.
There you go. I knew that was coming. Come on. You'll be asking me Harold or Alf next.
No. Which one
you go for?
What, between Harold and Alf?
No. Vegemite or Marmite?
Marmite and Vegemite.
Vegemite, every time. Vegemite, yeah.
Ooh, really? Controversial. Oh, okay.
What a traitor. That's disappointing.
Well, you know, it's because, you know, my eldest daughter was born in Australia and my wife's Australian. So it's, it's kind of, it's 2-2 in our house. So, and, you know, I think, as Australia has adopted me, I feel it's only right to assimilate the culture.
Very appropriate.
Okay, now I feel bad for calling you a traitor. I take it back.
Touring or track days?
Oh, blimey. I would say track days, but I would say doing the show would be number one. But given the choice of flying around, you know, being in airplanes all the time or sitting in the car, I'd far rather be doing a track day than the actual physical traveling every time.
Okay. Yeah. So what's your favorite place in the world?
Wow, my favorite place in the world. Ooh, probably here, because I moved here. Australia, but I like the Australian, I love the cities, but the Australian outback, and, you know, the bush is what I like.
Like a true native. In three words or less, describe what it was like doing a lap on the back of a two-seater MotoGP bike.
Am I allowed to say absolutely f***ing terrifying?
Yes. We can put a bleep in.
Massive. It was incredible. That was absolutely. Yeah. It was one of those things where, like, because I said basically, because I thought, you know, you're never going to get a chance to. You're never going to get a chance to experience that, you know. So it was basically like, right, do you want, you know, if you hold on and if I'm going too fast, like tap me on the shoulder or whatever. And I just said, look, I don't care if I come off. Let's just go just go all out. I basically said, just show off. And by the time we got to the first corner, I went, Oh God, no! This is not a good idea. It's incredible. He's just, you know, the front wheel was just, you know, he's just trail breaking into the new. Just you could feel. You think, how is the front not gone? And then just, you know, the front just, you know, we were like the front wheels coming off the ground while we were still leant over and stuff. It was, yeah, it was brilliant. What a treat. What an absolute treat. And at one point I looked up because it was just before the race. I couldn't really see where we were going. And I looked across and they had the cameras and they were sort of, you know, it was being shown on the big screen. And I looked up and I went, oh, look, there's me on the turn. And we went into the next corner. We're like, brilliant. Yeah.
Okay.
Right. So the person who taught you the most about riding.
The person that taught me the most about riding would probably be my mate Jimmy, James Burrows. He runs a in fact he works with so he's got this company called Body Clinic. He's got a gym and it's and he, you know, he trains regular humans, but he also trains a lot of he trains riders, and he also, because he's from a racing background and he trials dirt bikes, enduro, which is how I met him. And he's got a gym, and so not only does he sort of do regular training, but his focus is he trains motorcyclists and car racers as well, you know. So he's really good at he's just a really great I mean, he can get a bit grumpy and shout at you if you're not doing it right. But yeah, he's been the one that has taught me the most, I think. Yeah.
Awesome. Best place in the world to ride a bike.
Wow, the best place in the world to ride a bike. I would say, I think Africa. Is probably I mean Morocco, hence my love of the mint tea. the sand dunes in Morocco are just amazing. Like, because you've got these sort of like, you know, these 100-foot high to cathedral dunes, I think about 400-foot high, and it's just and the wind blows over the dunes and it gets rid of all the tracks. And you can just ride at these, you know, you'll have this 100-foot high, you know, like kind of like a wall, you know, just a wall of sand. And you can ride out right up it and, you know, go off the top of the dunes and get yourself in these like bowls that are like, you know, you can drop in and then you can ride around them like it's a wall of death and stuff. So it's amazing. Like, you've got to be careful. You don't, you know, if there's tourists on the camels, you got to listen out a bit. But I think probably Erg Chebbi in Morocco.
Perfect.
Okay. Well, I'm going to be heading there soon, even just to watch that. Three people from the motorcycling community. To take to dinner, who would you pick?
Steve Parrish would be the top of the list. Parrish is always he's just daft, you know. He's just always. I wouldn't eat the dinner if he'd had anything to do with preparing it or getting near it. From the motorcycle world, who else? Dougie Lampkin, 12 times world trials champion. What are you doing that's all wrong. Never oh, you made it over that, never.
That is a cracking impression.
That's exactly what it's like. Just that's it, you got it round the back. I would say Dougie, I would say a Parrish. Who else would I say? Probably Simon Pavey, the Dakar rider. Toby Price actually as well. He's he would be good. So, but yeah, probably Pavey, I reckon.
Awesome. Okay, then, last question. I mean, obviously, for everyone wondering about why Steve Parrish would be a bit of an issue cooking the meal, I mean, there could be some laxatives in there very easily. Just have a straight beeline for the toilet, I guess, in that case.
Just don't know. Like, he, I don't know if he's... Has he still got his pub? He, don't know if he has, but he used to have a pub, and he did food in the pub, and his missus brought all this amazing food out for us, and I was just like, really? And he went, I promise, I absolutely promise that I haven't touched it. I was like, all right, friend.
Okay, then, last question. In one sentence, why should everybody listening who isn't already start riding motorcycles?
In one sentence.
Or two, if you want.
But you can have plenty of sort of sub-clauses, commas, add lots of punctuation to make it a real Kerouac paragraph.
I would say you could probably sum it up with one word, really. Freedom, I would say. I think freedom, excitement, and focus, I would say, were the three things. I think the people who don't ride bikes, I think there's something about, you know, in these times where, you know, people sort of, you know, people, you know, that mindfulness seems to be the thing that everyone's trying to do nowadays, isn't it? Trying to be mindful. And I think there's something about riding a motorbike that just sort of, that for me anyway, it, because as long as you might be able to tell, it's quite a lot of noise in my head, you know, and it's kind of a lot of stuff knocking around in there, and riding a bike is just it's like you put your helmet on, and it's like you have to be incredibly focused. I get very easily distracted, but you got to put your helmet on, and it really sort of, it focuses you, because especially on the road, you think, I've got to be hyper aware, because, you know, assume that no one can see you, and there's that element of risk, you know, riding on the road. I suppose, you know, riding on the track or whatever, or off road as well, you know, that thing of, you know, especially if you're riding fast, and you sort of, you just, it forces your brain to be like 100% you have to be in the moment. That's the thing. You can sort of, you know, often in life, this is why I start sounding like the Dalai Lama, but in life, a lot of people are either thinking about, they're worrying about the future, and they're dwelling on the past. And on a bike, you have to be in the moment. You have to be where you are right there. But at the same time, there's a kind of meditative thing that goes on where, you know, sometimes you can drive home, you get home, you go, how did I end up here? But you were focused the whole time. And it just does that. You know, you put your helmet on, it just, everything just sort of, and it makes the noise go away. And it's, you know, when you're in the shower, or when you're in the shower and you sort of like, and you're washing yourself and you're away and you're thinking, right, it's going, oh, don't fall, don't slip on the soap and fall over. You know, that's in your head. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But it's like that. But you're washing yourself. You're in there because you have to wash yourself. But at the same time, your mind just kind of sort of is, your subconscious mind is kind of just playing around. So it's yeah. That's good.
I know what you mean.
I know what you mean
perfectly.
What a great way to finish.
So like, you know, if anyone tries to charge you for like, you know, sort of mental health, you know, things to improve your mental health, just, you know, to keep, save your money and buy a bike. That's what I say.
Brilliant. Well, I'll tell you what a great way to finish Kenwood Quickfire. We're going to start calling it Not So Kenwood Quickfire, because this happens every time. It just is probably the longest part of the show.
Why don't you, here's an idea, right? And this is me putting on my producer's hat. Why don't you get a Kenworth, that's a house. Why don't you get a Kenwood kettle and then fill it to the brim with cold water, turn it on, and you have to answer all the questions before the kettle boils.
That's genius. Actually a very good shout.
And the last question is, is that your coffee?
Oh, Ross Noble, you might have just secured a sponsorship for next year as
that's
well.
That's really annoyingly brilliant. Annoyingly because it wasn't my idea.
But you know what? It's one of those things where all of my gigs have been postponed. You know, I'm more than happy if Ken would want to, if they want to sponsor me, I would quite happily walk their kettles all around and the radios. Quickly, can I just plug a couple of things?
Of course, I was going to say, fire away. Absolutely.
Right, so I've got a podcast and I've just started it. It's called Ross Noble Podcast, up all night thinking of that. And it is myself and a mate of mine, Ed Cavalli, and we're going to be getting some guests on. And what we're doing is we pick a different music video each week and we just dissect the music video. Don't come on. If you're like a big music fan and you want insights into how the video was made, there's none of that. We basically talk about whether or not the video would cause problems for moths. That's one of our big things.
Wasn't that about the weekend blinding lights?
Yes, that's right. Brilliant. Yeah. So the first one was blinding lights, and most of it we talk for 15 minutes about whether or not the weekend. Who I think is called Theodore Weekend, that is just shortened down version of his name, whether he's lurching or lunging at a pigeon at the start of the video. So that gives you an idea of what that is, but you can get that on all the podcast stuff. And then I've also, for a limited time for a month, I've got six full shows from my Brain Dump tour, which are available on Soho Theatre on demand. They're £4 each and you can download them, and 40% of the money is going to Soho Theatre to help them stay open because they're not getting, there's no tickets being sold. And then I'm splitting the rest of the money with Acting for Others, which is a charity that helps people out who are of a theatrical nature who've fallen on hard times. So it's Soho Theatre on demand. So there's the visual, and then you can go to the podcast which is free. And there you go. So something Perfect. For everyone.
Something for everyone, definitely.
And I also I highly recommend the radio and kettle work of Mr. Kenwood. Kenwood, that's his name.
Yeah. Oh, brilliant, brilliant. Well, thank you so much for joining us. This has been so fun and funny. We'd love to do it again sometime in the future. We've got so much to talk to you about.
Yeah, well, when we get races back and we can have fans back as well, make sure you come and visit.
Yes, I shall hopefully see you in the flesh at some point.
Thanks a lot, Ross. Really appreciate it.
Thanks so much.
See you later. Bye-bye. You bye.
So, hope you enjoyed that episode. Here we are, back again to waffle at you. And Matt, you seem to be wearing a completely different shirt.
Yeah, I don't know really what happened. It might be that we've done the outro about a week later than the actual interview because you've had to swap around some guests. Could it be?
Could it be that we've swapped some stuff around?
We've had to change the schedule.
We have, but regardless, you can't tell with me, you see, because I own about 75 black t-shirts that all look pretty similar.
Yeah.
So things you need to search for after this one then, of course, the eponymous Des O'Connor, Ross Noble stuff, all the stuff that he mentioned, and also the freewheeling show, that was great. Who is coming up then in this reordered version of reality next week?
Well, the funny thing is we know who's coming up in the future, but other people don't and everything like that. But next week, we actually have a team boss back. We're switching it back to just inside MotoGP paddock. Razlan Rezali, the team principal of the Sepang Racing team, will be talking to us. We wanted to get in touch with him. Sorry for all those people expecting news about Rossi or whoever in 2021. It's not going to be about that at all. We want to talk about the rise of MotoGP in Southeast Asia, how that come about from a perspective on the inside. And also, we want to talk with Razlan about just how hard it really is in motorcycle racing at the very top level, from Moto3 to MotoGP. How hard is it as a team principal or as a rider? Should be a really, really interesting episode.
Yeah, definitely. I had a couple of chats with him at the CEV, I think, a couple of years ago. And there's some interesting stuff about Sepang and their role in it and sort of talent development and some of the hurdles that they face that others don't. Should be a good deep dive for those of you who take more of an interest in that and what it's kind of like to be in that position in the paddock.
And I think I don't know who exactly is listening, where you guys are from. I mean, let us know. Feel free to send us a comment or a tweet where you're watching from. But for those of you in Europe who might be watching MotoGP social media channels and wondering, what on earth is this language that's appearing on all these comments or on the Instagram lives? What's the language here? And or WKWKWK, as you see, you will get to understand how big MotoGP really is in Southeast Asia. It's truly fascinating.
It is. So shout out to everyone in that part of the world as well. Malaysia, Indonesia, you're all crazy for MotoGP, and MotoGP loves you too.
Yes.
So hope you enjoy that episode coming up, and thanks for watching this one. Or listening to.